All the time. You go anywhere and a taxi driver, and he'll tell you the same
thing.
I
was here first.
What about you? Oh, you go here. Oh, yeah, but that's me. Ah, I see.
Anyway, hello, I'm Klaus-Christian Zehbe, and actually I've diverted since the last 10 years from heritage. 10 years ago I was very much into heritage, being a graduate of the World Heritage Studies program, as well as a worker at the UNESCO Chair in Heritage Studies in Cottbus University. And 2014 was a transition for me. I started properly researching intangible heritage in Japan. So my research became involved already from the start with intangible heritage. However, my doctoral supervisor said this is an educational topic, and right he was, because it's about transmission things between generation. And that has informed significantly how I look at heritage, because it is deeply entrenched, like I said before, into the dynamics of generations. People are born into this world, and there is already something before them. And from an educational perspective, it's always the problem, how do you give that, especially from a social or like an institutional perspective or state perspective, how do you make good citizens? So people have to know where they come from, what is their past, in order to go to the future. However, interestingly, is for me, it is rarely focused on the future, it is more focused on the past, where people come from. I tried to show that a little bit, and I've want to introduce that, and the consequences for me are that it should be more participative. So I'd like to do later a little experiment with you, which I've prepared, which is also first off experiment, because I think it is important to open this process about discussing heritage to a more participatory approach, meaning it should be less hierarchical, meaning I shouldn't be here, we should be talking together. So this is what I tried to get to. And however, I'd like to start a little bit to give the framework of what I was dealing 10 years ago and where I'm standing with it now. Having talked about heritage and this kind of like homogenizing, nationalizing process, this is an example from Japan, and I think like a particularly good one, because it is the temple, in European terms, of the first shogun who unified the country. After an intense period of war in Japan, which is called actually also the period of warring states, which was around 1400, 1590 until 1600. So this shogun, he won a decisive battle, the Battle of Sekigahara, where lots of people got killed, and which was the first battle in history where lots of firearms were used. And as a consequence, he managed to cut off all political opposition and instate himself as the political ruler. Very successfully, until 1868, the lineage of the Tokugawa shoguns ruled in Japan, which is an incredible period of peace from 1600 to 1800, which is unparalleled in European history and I think difficult to find across the world. His successor, his grandchild, actually embellished this temple in order to show how great he was, and it is actually a quite spectacular heritage site. It is on the UNESCO World Heritage List. It is successful because of like superlative forms of artistic creation. These are the three monkeys of Nikko, which are admired by many people visiting there. It is rich in sculpture, in woodwork, incredible. This is actually also a very famous photo motif of what people do if they do heritage. So this is actually what you see in the site. I mean, like, it is nothing compared to Rome. I mean, like, I've been to the Colosseum and it is amazing how many people they pump through the site. However, people enter from the left-hand corner, and what you see here is a school children gathering area. You can see that there are school children by the colored caps. So one color for one group of school children, and they are actually waiting in order to move forward to have a group photo taken of their school visit to this heritage site. So actually, what happens to school children, you're taking to these places, you're being told what is important, and you're supposed to appreciate what it is. So actually you see another small group in the middle up where the three monkeys are, which I showed you. And then there's also like a community or amenity store where you can buy Lucky Charms, things what you buy as when you go places. So this is actually what you do heritage. However, this is not what I'm interested in. I'm asking myself the question is what happens, how to properly open it to the future. And this is what I was kind of like, the three areas again, and another work of art. And I mean, like what an art historian would do or somebody interpreting heritage would do is to explain that this is a social allegory for the coming age of peace. You have three people with a sleeping tiger, so you can be there with a dangerous animal and you're going to be okay. This is the promise of the Tokugawa shogunate. I'm the ruler, I made peace to the whole country of Japan, and you can be there safely. This is the social promise of the Tokugawas. But actually, if you look at what people usually do, I mean, like before they have been fighting, and I mean, like we have all these conflicts going on, it is apparently also part of human nature that we can't live so easily together with each other. So the question I'm started asking myself is, how can we use that kind of heritage site in order to discuss about the present? Not only just focusing at the past to look at where we came from, but also to make it meaningful to us today, what does it mean today? I had subtitle work in progress. I mean, like, I'm progressing, but I mean, like, it's not finished. So this is also part of a discussion which I would like to lead with you. So the question I ask myself is this actually a social utopia, or what would you have to do in order to make it actually work? I mean, like, this is an allegory. This is very clear. But how could actually people coexist? And then you come to the question, to the solution. It's not so easy. You can't be with a tiger because the tiger won't turn vegetarian, and you would have to do something. And then, in fact, if you looked at history, what the Tokugawas did, they established a quite strict police state, a strict social hierarchical order with no upward or downward mobility, perhaps, but no upward mobility, nothing. So you couldn't travel from A to B. You always had to ask for permission. They established a very rigid traveling system within Japan. They limited the power to one castle per feudal lord, and everybody had to be in the capital, not in their home base. So basically, they had a very strict oppressive regime, which only became open after Matthew Perry came with the American fleet and said, we'd like to have a contract with you, and we're going to abolish the Tokugawa state and reinstate the emperor again. That was in 1871. So that is the question which is actually lying behind it, but this is a story which is not being told with a picture, obviously, because, I mean, like, this is a social allegory. But if you think about the consequences, actually it has implications. So this is the most text you're going to get from me today, which is my current approach. I'm very interested in new materialisms, which is a school of philosophy which is trying to connect different entities across the planet and how it fits together. However, here I'm going back 100 years before to actually Karl Marx, who founded this particular stream of materialism, which I find very interesting. And this is also the point of departure of Ernst Bloch, which I find very exciting, which is a future direction of my research to explore. I'm going to tell you why. Marx, in his thesis on Feuerbach in 1845, wrote down basically the core of his philosophy. It's quite small compared to the works of Karl Marx in general, and especially The Capital. In this point, he worked very much against Feuerbach, and that was apparently at the time revelatory literature for him and Engels. So they read it all, and Feuerbach basically said, humans are estranged, and we should look at the material of what they do. However, Feuerbach was aiming at spirituality and Christianity in the end, and he said, theory is the biggest human achievement. When Marx read Feuerbach, he said, no, it's all wrong, because the thing what has been overlooked, if we look at material objects like that, is actually it has been created by humans. And this is basically what he says, that this contradiction is, if you look at any type of object, if you do something like I'm doing now, I mean, I already did something, but if I just do this, human activity is the core of everything, and this is what Marx basically postulates. If I do this, it can't be undone. If I'm doing this, it even worsely can't be undone. So this is going to stay forever, because somebody has done something, like Augustus, Hadrian, built something, and it's there to stay. So this is actually what drives people into the future. Somebody does that, and this is something basically anthropological fact of humans. We can't exist like that. We do things like this, and we leave things like that. However, if we look at it only from the perspective what people have done hitherto is in terms of what is left, you overlook the activity which created it. And that is the big idea of Marx, who said, look at the practice, what people do. So, I mean, like, who created this paper? I mean, like, he asked these questions, and if you are asking these questions, who created it? You come, it's the worker who created it. Where did he create it? It's the factory where he created it. It's the big person owning the factory, and what happens then? So, I mean, like, he opens all these questions, but the fundamental thing, what he writes down in these theses of Feuerbach is, it is basically practice what is founding human life as we see it. And this is what I'd like to go back to. However, and then this is the combination, what he does, it says in the last part of it that Feuerbach doesn't understand the revolutionary or the practical critical activity of humans. So that was the practical activity, and the missing part is the critical activity, which is important. So, practical, I demonstrated, this is for Marx creating history. Something is created, put into the world, and then we go on to use it, or we have to deal with it anyway, because we are in the world. But critical is, in that respect, quite interesting, because you look at it and say, like, oh, okay, I got two parts now. And this is the critical, how he understands it. We look at things, we perceive things, and we compare. And then we see one bit is uneven. Oh, it goes together. So, I mean, like, it enables another thing. So this kind of critical, practical activity is driving us forward. And in a way, I tried to exemplify that. This is a different take on what I did in 2014. Whole thing is looking for the tiger. I took the poem of William Blake, The Tiger, which is a quite famous poem. And if you look at the structure, all the verses are actually symmetrical, like bright night eye, symmetry. Symmetry? Symmetry?
Symmetry.
Symmetry. So it doesn't rhyme, but only the other skies, eyes, aspire, fire, art, heart, beat, feet, chain, brain, grasp, clasp, spears, tears, see, thee, bright night, eye, symmetry. So, I mean, like, in that point, it doesn't work out, obviously. And, I mean, like, yes, you can ask yourself questions. I mean, like, there is a structure, and then people recognize patterns. And so, I mean, like, you can ask yourself, how should it be? And actually, if you change it a little bit, actually, you make it work. I don't know if it should work like that. I mean, like, if you say try, I, rhymes. So, I mean, like, you could change it to symmetry and I. But, I mean, like, why would you do that? And maybe this is not what Blake wanted to say. Maybe he wanted to say, like, it's impossible to create that kind of thing. But you see, you do something, you perceive something, you see a pattern, and then you ask yourself questions, and then you try to deal with it. I mean, like, you can deal with it, but, I mean, like, I don't know if it should. But, I mean, like, all the poem readings of this tiger, they always say symmetry. Nobody says symmetry. I don't know how Blake would have said it, but, I mean, like, you see, I mean, like, I did something here, and maybe it continues to live. I don't know if it is worth doing it anyway. But, I mean, like, you can do things like that. So, the thing what I wanted to do, and this is what I believe should be, and I have in the time in between become actually deeply into educational studies, and also from more a general perspective, like why and what should we do about these transmission processes, but actually also to the concrete fact. And I'm becoming increasingly concerned with a younger generation, because, I mean, like, especially heritage is a discourse dominated by older people who say, like, oh, this is important, don't touch it. It has to be there for the future. So as a child, the world is already divided, like I said in this anecdote, and there's been people who tell you off. But, I mean, like, from an educational perspective, this is the core problem. Because, I mean, like, society wants, like I said, good citizens, and people want to have a good life. So this is, I hope, and society hopes these things meet. But, I mean, like, it becomes incredibly difficult to say that now if it still works, like, especially 50 years ago, 30 years ago. The world is rapidly changing. And, like, if we take the Club of Rome, what they predicted in 1972, and for me, reading or hearing about 1989, the second publication of the Club of Rome, that Earth ecosystems might collapse in 2030, which I thought at 1989, I can remember 1989. Wow, that's so far in the future. And now it's 6 years, 6 years to come. And if I look at my daughter, wow, she's going to be really in this process. And I mean, there are changes, and actually my doctoral father reported going with a car on the motorway and having to clean the windshield because of all the insects being caught. You don't do that anymore. There is no more thing like that at the filling station because there's no more insects. And you go in China and you take a little cotton ball and you go like that personally in order to do what the insects did before. So I think, like, there is something fundamentally changing, and I think, like, this is something what we have to address, and I think, like, we have to actually also discuss about it and open it to the discussion, and this is actually what I'd like to do. The following exercise, and I'm going to keep it into very short format, I'm going to give you a small scenario which I'd like you to think about. This is the scenario. You're living in a heritage site. If you want to, choose the heritage site which is ideal for you or which comes to your mind. What do you see? What do you smell? What do you touch? Are there people with you? What do you do? Or what would you like to do in this heritage site? Just think about this for a moment. And I'm going to give you one card. You can draw one card, which is a social role, and then you can figure out the next step. But just think while I'm kind of like passing through and giving you cards to draw, and think about the heritage site, what your, how that is, how that feels. Try to picture it as clearly as possible. Thank you.
Michele, spiegamelo bene, non ho capito. Adesso qui ci ha dato questo.
Leggi.
Dobbiamo rispondere a questa domanda.
Is the yellow one for a second question?
I'm going to just think about the heritage side. I mean, if you can turn it, it around.
Okay.
I mean, like, I'm not going to ask you about the heritage sites. I mean, like, just imagine that for the moment.
Okay.
No, just think about it. Because I mean, like, that's, I think, like, it's also, I consider this private in a certain way.
Can you repeat the exercise for my new student?
Right, okay.
Thank you.
So, just come, have a seat.
Yeah.
Right, oh, I'm running out of pencils. I hope you have, okay, just for a while.
I have 100.
Okay. So, I'm asking you to just imagine you're living in a heritage site. Any heritage site you choose. I mean, like maybe because you're coming from here, but you have.
Yes.
And nothing
in the so I mean, like, just imagine that type of heritage site. Can be ideal when.
Can be anything what you want, anywhere. I mean, like, if you are living in Rome, I mean, like, basically you're living in a huge heritage site, but I mean, like, not necessarily where you want to live, but I mean, like, something where you want to live, where you think you are happy and you are enjoying it. So have something, and then think as clearly as possible, like, what do you see? Can you see clear? Near you, can you see far? What is in the distance? How does it smell? What season is it? What kind of weather?
Sorry, I also.
Oh, scusa. So.
You can, I mean, like, obviously, I mean, like, I gave you a pen and a paper. I mean, like, you can draw.
But you can also fold, you can do anything with it. I'd like you to create something for yourself. You know, how that the thing what you have here connects to this heritage site. And then the next step is to look at the yellow card and then anything what you like. You can do, you don't have to draw, but I ask you to create something because this is the important bit, what I think is crucial. Like, people create something and it goes into the future. Like I said before, if I fold it like this, it cannot be undone. This is basic anthropological assumption of me, you or Marx. Wow.
Interesting.
Myself in the line of Marx. Okay. Whatever it is. So, I mean, like, I ask you to create something for yourself. You know, not necessarily, but I mean, like, for yourself, that it connects to this vision of the heritage site in this life. Anything at all, just a tiny bit. But because we're under time pressure, I mean, like, don't take too long. And I'm here working with inspiration of two people from New York, who actually created it as a complete methodology, but I'm quite brutally diverting here from that methodology. It's actually a company they founded, it's called More and More, and they have a card deck, which is asking that kind of questions for people to imagine futures. However, I mean, like, I was looking for something more heritage-based, which they haven't got. So, I mean, like, this is a proxy for that kind of thing. So I'm, if you're interested in that kind of methodology, I'm happy to share link and information and how to get it in, or in, get into contact with people. This is not quite what I do here is based on them, is based on their ideas, but is actually quite modifying these ideas. So if it fails, this is actually my fault and not theirs. So. Okay.
Okay,
done. Okay. So, I mean, like, it doesn't have to be perfect, but just for you yourself as a reminder. And I think like the important bit is that you enjoy it and you want to be there. So, and now comes the other part. We all know the world isn't a walk in the park and it's not all pretty and nice. It's kind of like we're like other people say, hell is other people. Sartre, Camus. So, look at the card and what it says on your card. And actually, I think like this is also a little bit like life. I mean, like it's sometimes quite random what happens to us. So, I mean, like this is also, look at the card and it has a social role. So think about how that social role connects, how you can connect these two.
No, it's too late.
It's too late, but I'm getting to it anyway. So, how does it connect? Does it make your life easier, the social role, or what are the implications? And I think like the methodology, just to give you a preview, because we can't go through the whole process, but. Actually, what I'd like to do, if time permits, is if you looked at your role, and then if you're sitting together, kind of like with a person, maybe you can just briefly, for 5 minutes or so, I think like without too much overrunning the time, maybe just briefly discuss into these two people you're sitting next to, or groups of three, can you build a world together? Where it all fits in.
Perfect. So we have the World Heritage Site we're in, and then we have this role
yes.
connected to the future. Can you explain a little more how they relate?
Right. So, I mean, like, this is the world where you live in, and now you've got a social role in that world. So that is the world which you imagined, which is kind of like the ideal world which you'd like to live in, which is maybe something aspiring to go to. And then you have the social role, which is kind of like putting limitations on you and also putting you into a social context. And the question kind of like I'd like to ask is, can you build in small groups, can you build a world together where you can make it fit? Can you kind of like develop a shared utopia which got space for all of you?
Imagine.
So I mean, like this is maybe just a small group discussion. So think about it. You know, can you make something in the groups where you got in together? Can you make it into one thing where you can share?
Are you also
We've also a dance player.
Yeah.
It's like the kind of Washington forest, right?
Yeah. But the like rivers,
So now, but the
but a beautiful stone
Okay, but I think yeah, we haven't got the 5 minutes, but okay.
Man, you will enjoy something
a lot. So, I mean, like, maybe just I'm curious, what did you experience? What are maybe things you'd like to keep, or how did it work? How did it work well? How didn't it go well? What can be done, or what should be done? I mean, like, you could also think about if you, but that's a dangerous thought. I mean, like, if you were wanted something to be done, what can you do yourself? I think, like, that's the better question, rather than kind of like ask your boss or ask the mayor or your political representative to do it for you. So I think, like, rather ask a question. So what is it possible, how you could get to that future you envisioned? And was it easy to build it, to combine it? I think, like, this is what I'm really interested in. And I think, like, this is what for myself, the discussion should be, and obviously it's also a very difficult social discussion, but that is the question I'd like to put to you. Would you like to share something of your experiences, what happened to you in these last 4 minutes?
This, the real question is what you can do. So the focus of it, even in the slide about Feuerbach and Marx, the idea is it depends on our interpretation. If we interpret everything like a collective view, it's technically impossible, and we get to something wishful, nice, valuable, but technically not feasible, because it, you rely on too many heterogeneous things and people. So the thing you can do, my view, is very elementary, which is transform everything into a subjective, intimate view, which is what I need to view. Still, I mean, the concept of urgency comes back.
Yes.
So good. If I get as an interpretation of heritage, of whatever society, even of desire, my urgencies, my brutal urgencies, I try and act in a very minimal kind of sphere, my sphere of proximity. I was telling before, I can make you smile. I can't make the world smile. Mm. So it's a crafting a chain of very small, even invisible rings, in which everything is slowly, slightly moving. And this, in a medium term horizon, generates something which is, of course, selective, but it's in some way put yourself in a connection, in a, say, network connection with people who, without telling each other, look at the same point of horizon. I mean, personally, I remember the really dramatic moments in my life. I'm not exaggerating, of course, but bad news, blah, 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 normal, but I mean, where, when I felt I was alone thinking something or viewing something, and when you feel you can't communicate, you can't share any feeling, even a stupid feeling. So maybe if we work on this crafting, it's almost invisible underground, but you do it. And this implies that you can have a view, and this can make a critical mass, which implies, last thing, just sorry about being long, but I mean, it implies that you need an adult society. People not irresponsible, not in the way happy to say, do it for me.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. 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 Yes. 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 Yes.
I really love this exercise in the sense that it acts us to be more active in the thought process. I think the difficulty was that we all have different physical places, so how it kind of be where are we connecting and how are our roles connecting, but. I think the thing that I was missing was like a challenge or something that would unite us around like how we position and relate to each other, you know, so that we can also position ourselves in relationship to time and the space. So for me, I was kind of trying to come up with a problem to solve in order to know how to apply the role in relationship to the space. You know, it's like, I'm an artist, maybe I make baskets and like to help people, you know, just trying to construct the reality a little bit more.
Actually two comments. I mean, like in the first version, I created like a scenario card as well, which is founded on literature, but actually the founders of these exercises, they said, don't do that because it's founded on a dystopian future. And they very rightly said, if you are creating a dystopian future, like a challenge, you're working against, but basically you're affirming what is there. This is their philosophy. I mean, like in a way, it's very right, because if you, for example, if you say like, imagine a George Orwell world where there is a special agency which goes around and destroys everything which is 100 years old, automatically erasure, like buildings being taken down by a special agency. So no history. And I mean, like that creates something. Obviously, but basically then you're affirming the idea because you're working against it. This is their philosophy, and they actually like to work from imagination, and which is also a little bit, I mean, like Marx doesn't really use it, but it actually I find, and this is why I'm interested in Ernst Bloch now, his philosophy of hope, who is actually working really on these 11 theses of Feuerbach's Bach on from Marx, and which he takes as a point of departure to create his philosophy of hope. So, I mean, like, I haven't read Bloch enough in order to kind of like safely present it here. But I think like this is a trajectory for me, which I become really interested in to study that. And he just takes this point as a departure. And I think like this kind of like going into the future and not to constrict it, I think like is an important point. I mean, like it doesn't necessarily say good or bad, because I mean, like we've got obviously enough stuff on this planet to handle and manage. But I think like for the two people in New York, and they were very strict or kind of adamant about it and said like, no, don't do that. Don't take it as a challenge. Use imagination. I don't know which works best, because this is the first time actually I use that or kind of like try to use it. But I think what I try to get to is actually this, what you described. I mean, like kind of like you can't, nice, really nice metaphor, you can't make the world smile, but you can make people smile close to you. And then the challenge actually, and this is the Rousseau challenge in a way, I mean, like Rousseau tried in his Emile and also in his Social Contract, he tried to create that social utopia where everything works, everybody is reasonable, but people aren't, because this is also basically human nature. I mean, like we are not reasonable, we are driven by many things, which is our environment, which is how we are brought up and so on. It's so uncontrollable. That's why he wrote Emile, where he controls the puppet of Emile until the point where he becomes reasonable. It's an amazing feat creating that kind of model. It works for Rousseau, but it doesn't work for people. But I mean, like that is my educational question, because I mean, like obviously you have to connect it from an institutional and a personal point of view. And I think like the only solution is possibly to create that kind of small networks. And actually this type of exercise is aiming at that kind of thing, to create networks, to build critical mass, to maybe focus on one perspective. Because I think like, rightly so, what you said, it's very possibly heterogeneous. And I think like missing step is identify shared points of your vision. Which...
That's a point which I find important. I'm experiencing it in my professional slash personal life, which is authorizing people to express themselves out of the conventions. So a big work I'm performing with, I normally work a bit with much younger people than me, so it's a good exercise. And they are very afraid, quite normally, they're afraid of admitting they desire something, because it's not right, it's not convenient, it's unjust, it's prohibited, blah, blah, blah. Even people who are not compelled into, say, religious dogmas, etc. Conventions are like this. I mean, the point is, I defend the idea, I'm saying something stupid, but I mean, I like being stupid, that until it was aristocratic word, it was eccentric. Bourgeoisie is conventional. Mm. So maybe the password is not as they taught us, because I think that there are much more slaves in a company, in a manufacturing company, than in a royal palace. We can discuss hours about this, but I mean,
point taken.
Since finally this cut of 2 centuries ended, let's craft the word.
Yes. And addition to that, I think like it's also some, connecting to something what you said previously. I think around 1900, especially in Germany, something happened, which is kind of like both coming together with an institutionalization of society, because around 1920, mass schooling started in Germany, where you, I mean, like this is common everywhere now. You put all people through this process and everybody is supposed to get the same values, the same knowledge and so on. And at the same time, you have also mass production like that. And Walter Rathenau, at one point, former president of German Republic around 1920, he said, now you find like warehouses, like department stores, where there's more objects in this single house than could be found in a whole block of buildings, what people owned. So I think like there is a process around 1920 in Germany at least, where these things suddenly change and where also the relationships change and where Marx actually appeared. And then at the same time, also something scary, I think like it was a German social democrat who said, we can have growth away from the biological metaphor, because growth is something, you grow something, autumn comes, it declines, it decays, and it dies in winter. And he said, no, it's possible to have growth, unlimited, forever. And I think like since then, I think like from 1920, things changed, and that I think like we have to become aware, and again, tying to history, like how it comes our problems from.
coming back to the, you know, the one person, it's interesting. When you talk about George Orwell or Eric Blair, that's his real name, he produces 1984, yeah, this big impact. And before that, he's down and out in Paris, yeah. Anna Funder, an Australian writer, amazing writer, who's also written about East Berlin, the Stasi, she wrote the biography of his wife, Eileen. Oh, he couldn't make her smile, see? Yes, he couldn't. George Orwell, so there's this, this is a big discussion about famous men and their work and whether they're good people, sure. But, you know, it makes me think how some people, how they can't take that intimate personal responsibility, yes? It just can't happen. They can't do it, yeah? But he did that on another scale of a certain kind. And so you have these dichotomies as well within this taking of a commitment to society and to, yeah.
We overrun, I think. Thank you.
Time for lunch, I imagine, right?
Oh.